So let's continue with example six. We saw a reasonably lengthy example in number five, and it's a mixed bag. Sometimes you get a simple example, a simple question, sometimes you get a complicated one, and it's not obvious what the question is going to require, which is maybe a little intimidating, but it's important that I just look at the question for what it is and not assume that it's going to be difficult or assume that it's going to be very straightforward. Example six. The strategy here, I guess, is that I'm trying to illustrate is make or let's say use a diagram. These are just sort of suggestions to help us see different things, different kinds of questions, different approaches. Often, just making a little sketch or trying to visualize something helps me a lot. This would be one of those examples. So let's read the question. After completing repairs on an elevator, a maintenance engineer tested his work by sending the elevator up 12 floors, down 18, and back up 20. If the elevator ended up on the 30th floor, on which floor did the engineer begin his test? Now, on the surface, it's not a complicated question. We just have to systematically work backwards. So with a little sketch, we can figure it out easily. So where did I end up? I ended up on the 30th floor. So let's say this is the 30th floor. So how did the elevator get to this point? It was sent up 20 floors to end up here. So it came from which floor?
10th
floor. Let's write it over here. So I'm just systematically working backwards. How did it get there? It was sent down 18 floors. So it came from the 28th floor. How did it get to the 28th floor? It was sent up 12 floors. From where? 16th. And that seemed to be where the elevator started. Is that right? Did I do everything correct? You have to always check on my arithmetic. So just by starting at the end, working backwards, it seemed like the elevator started, or he began his test, on the 16th floor. So let's just say a little sentence here. Started on 16th floor. So for me personally, I can only say how I feel about these questions. Doing this in my head without seeing something nice and concrete on paper or on a board makes it very easy to get confused. I can't keep track of that many numbers in my head. So making a little diagram, something to visualize and see and work through, makes it just much easier and takes all the guessing out of it. Any questions on this? So again, some questions are very simple, some not so much. What about number seven? So I guess the strategy here is, let's just say make a list. Doesn't really help me to know the strategy. How many different four-digit numbers have the same digits as 1977? In other words, how many ways can I shuffle those digits around to make different numbers? The only way for us at this point to figure out how many ways I can do that is just list them. So my numbers, let's put them in curly brackets. 1, 7, another 7, and a 9. These are the numbers that I want to arrange in all the possible ways. So the thing here that is good practice is to make a list in such a way that I'm systematically working through it, that I make sure that I don't miss anything. If I just randomly start shuffling them, how do I know that I have every possible arrangement? So that's the thing, to systematically work through them. So my strategy to do that is to start with the smallest one first, and then look for all the possible combinations to go with the number one. When I've done all of those combinations, then I'll put the next possible number in the first position with all the possible combinations, and then the next one. And when I run out, then I know I've covered all the possibilities. So how many numbers can we make with a 1 in the first position? 7, 7, 9, that's 1. Let's now try and, so I'm fixing this 1, and I'm looking at everything else. Now of these 3, how many ways can I shuffle them? Well, let's just fix the first position. The first position is either a 7 or a 9. How many different numbers can I make with a 7 here? It's this one. So the 1 is not an option. I don't have an option to change that. 7 is not an option. And the only other arrangement is a 9 and a 7. So it seems like I'm overdoing this, but I'm trying to emphasize a systematic approach to making my list. Now I've run through all the possibilities that have a 7 in this position in front of these 3. So the next one has to be a 9. Then I don't really have a choice. It has to be a 7 and a 7. Because those are identical, the 2 7s flipped around, I can't really tell the difference. So I fixed the 1 in the first position. Then I go to all the possibilities for the next position. There's nothing else I can put in this position. And with each of these, I've covered all the possibilities. So there's nothing else that goes with a 1 in the first position. So then I go to the next possibility, which is a 7 in the first position. And I can see everything that can go with that 7 in the first position. To be a 1, a 7, or a 9 in the next position. And I'll look at each one of these possibilities separately. So now I have a 7 and a 1. What else can go here? 7 and 9, or 9 and 7. So 7 is fixed, the 1 I'll fix temporarily, and I can look at all the arrangements that go with them. Then I have a 7 in the first position. I've looked at all the possibilities with the 1 next, so I'll go with the next highest number in the next position. Then what do I have left? A 1 and a 9, or a 9 and a 1. So I can't do anything else with that 7, so let's go to the next number, which is a 9. 1, 7, and 7, 1. Do you see sort of the systematic way that I'm working through this? It's, for me, it's difficult in the beginning, but once you do it a few times, it becomes easier. That's everything with a 9. I've covered all the possibilities for that second position. So that gives me everything with the 7 in the first position. Then I go to the next position. Let's use all the space here, which is a 9. Now you can tell me, which one can I put first? I just start systematically. So with the smallest one first. Then I have 7 and 7. I can't do much with them. So that's the only one here, so then I increase this to the next one, which is 7. And then I can have 1 and 7, or 7 and 1. Can I increase this guy anymore? Fixing the first. The other guy is 7, and that's the same. So I only have two options for the second position. The 9 is fixed. The 9 is out of the question once I'm at this position. So 1 and 7, they were really the only ones available. I can't tell the two 7s apart. So that's the end of my list. And then, once I have my list, the issue was working through this in a way that guarantees me to not miss anything. I can just count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So, we have 12 numbers in the list. The issue isn't really the 12. It's actually making the list in a systematic way. That is the challenge. Any questions on this? Yes?
Is there any way you could like make a formula for these
questions?
Or do you not really?
For the list? Or for the number?
Just for like the question. So like if you had another question that was like, you know, like 635, how many different ways can you make those numbers?
To me, the whole point here is to avoid that. I know that's not what you want to hear. I want to get away from the let's say, the comfort of, if this question looks like this, then I apply this. If this question looks like this, then I apply this. And I'm more interested in sort of why. What do I do with this question? And once I do enough of them, I maybe can come up with my own sort of link, but I'm trying to get away from the plug and play feeling, that if it's this, then I do this. If it's this, then I plug it into this format. We're trying to emphasize the way of thinking, and to do that is, the way we do that is to get away from that, and every time I have to rethink, what do I do? What is the question asking, and so on. Sort of practice that way of thinking. Otherwise, if I have a formula, then I don't really think much. I don't think at all. A formula is there to take the thinking out. And we want to emphasize the thinking, so we want to get away from a formula for these, at least. I know, I'm just being... Number 8, I put in here, I think, just for fun. Just for fun. Show that some questions just you have nowhere to hide, really. You have nowhere to hide, no formula, nothing. No previous experience, no previous example, you just have to look at the question. Now, I put it in here because we can discuss it. I'm not necessarily expecting you to be able to come up with these things on your own. Some of these questions are worth doing, but they're not necessarily test questions or exam questions. And I think this is one of them that is worth seeing, but I'm not going to put it in a test. 8 marbles look alike, but one is slightly heavier than the others. Using a balanced scale, how can we determine the heavy one? There's one marble that's slightly heavier. How can we find it if we only have 3 opportunities to use the scale? What's a balanced scale? What's a balanced scale? Who doesn't like balanced scales? Anyone?
It just weighs the...
It just balances the 2 sides. Let me make a little sketch. I put little marbles in there if I want, and then one side is going to be heavier. in the other one, and that's all the information I can get. That's the only information I can get. So, if I have 8 marbles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now, this question is just for us to sort of just sit back and think a little bit. See something. I'm not going to write out the detail of the solution in any way, because we can talk about it here. How? What's the obvious way, the first thing that comes to mind for you and for me, to try and find, to try and systematically weigh marbles, to try and find the one that's heavy? Yes?
Maybe first, like, spin up four, and then see which side weighs more.
I mean, like this?
Yeah.
So I have 4 marbles, I don't know, the heavy one's somewhere. Split it up into 2 groups. One of these groups will be heavier, will be the heavier one.
And then split it into 2 again.
Right? So let's suppose this one's heavier. That means the heavy marble is necessarily in here. Then I take these 4 marbles, split it into 2 again. One of these sides will be heavier. Let's suppose it's this one. Then I have 2 marbles. Split it in 2, put 1 marble on either side, and I will find the heavy. So that's the obvious one.
Sure.
How many times have I used the scale? Once here to eliminate half of them. So let's say this is 1, then another 1, and oops, second weighing, and then the third time I find the marble. I think that feels perfectly natural. Everyone would come up with that one first, including me. Can we do it by using the scale exactly twice? Only twice. Now again, let me say, don't feel anything if you can't see. I have the benefit of looking at the solution first, so I see very smart. But I probably wouldn't see it either. These things, you have nowhere to hide, you have nothing to use, you just have to look at this, which makes it really difficult. Can we use the scale only twice? It's hard. This is sort of, this, the question like this tells me a lot. Teaches me something. Nothing ever says that I have to weigh all the marbles, or I have to have all the marbles on the scale at the beginning. I just assumed that with this. It was a nice, straightforward strategy, sure. But I don't have to weigh all the marbles to necessarily know something about them. What if we, let me write, draw the marbles here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. What if I split this into groups like this? Now, I don't know where the heavy one is. Split it like that. Now, I want to go slow enough so everyone understands the method, because I'm not going to write it out. It's just too long in words to put everything down. What would happen, or what are the possibilities, if I weigh those 2 groups of 3, those 2 threes, and I put them on the scale? What could happen? Let me put the other scenario over here. Now, I don't know where the heavy one is. What could happen if I take these 2 groups and I put them on the scale?
One could be heavier or they could be equal.
Okay, so let's suppose one is heavier. So let's say heavier, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's very close to the door. Or they're the same. I'm very happy that those are my 2 possibilities. one of the two things. We'll either do nothing or one is heavy. What does it mean? What does it tell me, the information it gives me, if this happens, if one side's heavier than the other?
The heavier marble
is necessarily among those three. So I can rule out these two without ever having touched them. Strange. Very different, yes. So without actually putting a marble on the scale, I know something about that marble. And that these, I don't care about them. They're not the heavy ones. Now I've narrowed it down to three. Let me separate them a little bit. What can I do now? I have one chance left. Yes.
You weigh two of them, and if they're the same, then the one you didn't weigh is heavier.
Yeah.
If they're not, then the one is heavy.
Take any two of them. If they're the same, so let's say then either one is one is heavier, or if I take these two, it's the same. If one's heavier, then I'm done. That's the heavy one. If they're the same, what then?
Then
it's this one. And I'm done again. So I can find the marble without actually weighing it again. I'm going to help you with the strategy. Again, it's lengthy and complicated to really write that out in nice sentences. So I'm just trying to get the idea. So if you're not sure, please ask. Everyone happy with this scenario? Yes. What happens in the other one? Now I split them into three, three, and two. Weigh these two groups, they're the same. What does that mean?
It's one of
the heavy one is necessarily one of these two. There's only one heavy one. So I just eliminated a whole bunch. And now if I have two marbles, well, that's fine. Split them into two, weigh them, and done. So regardless of what happens my first my first chance, regardless of what happens, I still only need one more chance. Only two chances. Strange, I don't think I would have come up with this. There's no shame in saying I wouldn't have come up with this at all. Strange. This one I think everyone can come up with. This one not so much. So maybe if you're, I know it's only Monday, maybe if you have nothing else to do tonight, think, how high can I go? How many marbles can I compare before needing another chance? Can I do 9? 10? How high can I go? Before I definitely need another use of this guess. I think we can do 9 like that as well. Anyway. Interesting. It's just interesting to see these things. Let's get back to something a little bit more mathy, I guess. Sometimes we get problems that lend themselves very nicely to using equations and variables and things like that. So let's call the next strategy for the next group of examples using equations and variables. This is probably the thing that people want to avoid, but the whole point of an equation and a variable is to take the guessing out of it. Like this marble example, I just have to see. What if I just don't see it? Sometimes I can have a question where it's complicated and I can't just see things and know what to do. Variables and equations give me a way to take the guessing out of it. Set up things nicely, solve them, and the answer comes out without me having to just magically see it. So a variable in the simplest sense is just sort of a placeholder for a number. I just don't know what the number is behind the variable. Some unknown number. An equation is just some combination of numbers and variables with an equal sign and then some other combination, saying that some value, it might have a variable, so I can't see all the numbers, but it represents a number essentially, is equal to some other combination of numbers. Now this is all very vague, and I think that's what scares people.